Welcome back. Well, like a rocket ship, Hebrews chapter 1 shot up to the heavens to say, above all, look at Jesus. Jesus, the Son of God, superior to the angels and reigning over the universe. He is worthy of your trust, first century struggling persecuted Christian. And to us today, the scripture says he is worthy of your trust, 21st century struggling persecuted Christian. Let me remind you of our memory verse for Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. Now, with all that powerful imagery of who Jesus Christ is, we're going to continue in chapter 2 to see Jesus Christ as the superior person. Please open your Bible to Hebrews chapter 2. Grab a pen and a paper and please pray with me. Jesus, you came as our perfect God, with the only one who could do the work on the cross to redeem us. So we look to you, superior above everything else, everyone else, as our only Abba Father, who loved us so much that you acted in such a pursuing way to be with us forever. So we ask that you write these truths on our heart. In your name, precious Lord Jesus, amen. So we are so grateful to get to have these words of God in the scripture. That's what the Bible is God's words. And so I pray that you treasure them. So let's read chapter 2, verse 1 in Hebrews. We must pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard so that we do not drift away. Our first command in Hebrews is pay attention to what you have heard. Now I want to ask you, are you paying attention to what you read in scripture? What you hear your pastor preach? God's word is not just to be heard. God's word is to be obeyed. And it can only be obeyed when we truly pay attention, right? You don't know how to live life unless you pay attention and put it in context. You know there's a difference, right? I put my earbuds in, I'm listening to podcasts while I'm making smoothies, and I'm listening, and I'm chopping, and I'm blending. But am I really paying attention to what I'm hearing? You know there's a difference, right? So why does the author say we should pay attention with such urgency? Now, the scripture tells us it's so we don't drift. The book of Hebrews has 5 warnings, and it will be easy to remember because they're all D's: drifting, doubting, dullness, despising, and denying. So our first one is drifting. And what comes to mind when you think of drifting? Perhaps drifting off to sleep or drifting into the next lane when you're driving. Or perhaps you think of Tom Hanks as a castaway. So lonely, he befriends a volleyball named Wilson. Do you remember this movie? Do you remember the scene in this movie? Tom and the volleyball Wilson, they're on a raft when a huge wave crashes and washes Wilson off the raft. And Tom is sleeping, but as soon as he recognizes Wilson is gone, he dives into the waters to rescue Wilson. But the current is causing Wilson to drift further and further away, and Tom is hanging onto the raft. He's torn between the safety of the raft or following the current and the ball to his death. And you can hear Tom cry out, right? Wilson, Wilson, I'm sorry, Wilson. Only an actor of Tom Hanks quality can make grown-ups cry over a volleyball drifting away in the ocean. But this image is real, right? Believers can get caught in the current of culture and they drift away from a secure joy, eternal safety of Jesus. They drift to the pull of an easier life, a delight in material things, and it threatens to pull us to our death. Perhaps a tragic life event has crashed into your life, causing you to drift from God and His Word. It happens slowly and gradually. It happens while you are asleep. And so the scripture says, pay attention, because the truth is you never drift toward holiness. You always drift toward ungodliness. You never drift toward faithfulness. You drift toward self-centeredness. And you never drift toward life. You drift toward death. So let me ask, are you spiritually drifting? John Corson, he writes, most of us are not in the danger of plunging into the ocean of perversity, but we are in danger of drifting away from goodness, and it happens almost imperceptibly. Are you drifting away from God? Caught in the current of culture, or perhaps caught in the net of your own life's disappointments? You know you are drifting when you listen to God's word, but your mind is not transformed. So let's continue on reading Hebrews chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. So do not drift away, for if the message spoken by angels was binding and every violation and disobedience received its just punishment, how shall we escape if we ignore such a great salvation? This salvation which was first announced by the Lord and was confirmed by those who heard him. Here's the argument. If the message of angels shouldn't be ignored, and we've already seen Jesus is superior, how much more must we treasure the words of Jesus? Having established Jesus as superior to everyone and everything, and Jesus alone redeemed us from sin's punishments, if the writer can't stand it any longer, he says, do you believe what Jesus has said? You cannot ignore this. You have heard it. You have to respond to it. This is an invitation of God. And so what is your response to the King of the universe? What is your response? God is asking you to pay attention and respond. Are you waiting to get over your struggle or to get out of your mess? Are you waiting to have fun today and let tomorrow play out? That's just drifting. And drifting through life is so easy, but all one must do to go to hell is to continue to ignore the invitation of God. And so the author of Hebrews, and I sit here too, say, please don't ignore so great a salvation. You are never going to have a better offer. And there's no such thing as standing still spiritually. You are either moving forward spiritually or you are drifting backward, away from God and away from the things of God. So will you honestly consider the trajectory of your relationship with God? Are you getting to know God? Let's go on in Hebrews chapter 2. And chapter 2, verse 6 quotes from Psalm 8. It says, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him? You have made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor, and you've put everything under his feet. In God's creation, angels are spiritual. Man is physical. We know that, right? Angels are spiritual, man is physical. But God has revealed his plan for eternity. God intends for redeemed men and women, you and me, to rule his kingdom. Genesis chapter 1 verse 28 said, God revealed his original assignment for man. He said, have dominion over every living thing that moves on the earth. That was God's plan for us. But we chose sin, and instead of obedience, we disobeyed and we lost dominion over nature. And so verse 8 says, at present, we don't see everything that is subject to him. But then comes one of my favorite verses in chapter 2 verse 9, but we see Jesus. I will miss a lot of God's leading. I will disobey and mess up. I will deny God's good ways for me. I will defy God even when he asks for the simple things. But even through all that, I can see Jesus. He's who I can always see. No matter how cloudy your days or how messy your lives, we see Jesus. Because Jesus came to earth, and Jesus walked, and he talked, and he lived, and he loved. And then when he rose again, he gifted his Holy Spirit in you and me the moment we cast our life on Jesus as our Savior. And so when we see our new hearts, we see Jesus. And when we're in our church body with others that have received Jesus, the Holy God, the Holy Spirit, we see Jesus. The writer of Hebrews explains three reasons Jesus came. Jesus came as God's answer to mankind's dilemma. Our sin stands in the way of our destiny. That's what Jesus said, what God had wanted for us. And so let's read chapter 2, verse 9. So, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. Jesus became a man to suffer and die for your and my sin. Through this, Jesus restored our lost destiny. Jesus then came to call us as family. Let's read chapter 2, verse 11. Both the one, Jesus, who makes men holy, and those who are made holy are of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers. He pulls a quote from Isaiah. Here I am, and the children of that God has given me. I love when he pulls from all these Old Testament places. It is immensely logical that God, who made everything for his glory, would, through the suffering of his son on the cross, lead broken, drifting people to glory. Jesus does that. People to call his family. And then the third thing is Jesus came to free us from death. Notice here the author draws on his use of the Isaiah quote to explain Jesus' work was both one for the entire universe, but also intimately for one, you and me. Jesus would have died for as a father protects his children. So let's read chapter 2, verse 14. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death he might destroy him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. So behind death, the writer sees Satan's power, the devil. He calls him out. Jesus did not have to die, but he gave his life voluntarily to deal with the devil, the greatest enemy of God's children. Physical death for non-believers means spiritual death, separation from God. Physical death for non-believers means spiritual separation from God forever. That's living eternally in the full wrath of judgment for sin. That is what the Bible explains. But for everyone who casts their life on Christ, though we are still going to physically die, our souls live forever with Christ. That's the promise of those who believe, forever worshiping our Creator and our Redeemer. What else would we want to do? And so this verse explains this work of Christ has an immediate blessing today. It's delivering the redeemed even from the fear of death, not just death, but the fear of death, liberating you from a spiritual death manifest all around us in depression and fear and restlessness and despair and defeat. So what fears enslave you? What unsatisfied restlessness enslaved your heart? If you felt like the writer drifted from his main point of exalting Jesus above everything, verse 16 pulls us right back. He says, for surely it is not angels he helps, but Abraham's descendants. Only by living himself could Jesus help us struggle with this great temptation that we have as we travel the road to eternal glory with God forever. Because Jesus suffered and Jesus remained sinless. Even when he was tempted, he walked the same road of hard things. Because he is sinless, he is able to help us be victorious in those same temptations you and I face every day. So where are you being tempted? Knowing Jesus suffered your same temptations, knowing Jesus walked through your same temptations and stayed pure and holy, will you ask God to guide your steps as you walk through hard places in this life? Because God has traveled your road, you can trust God's guidance. Jesus' help is constantly available to those who come to Jesus trusting him alone. As verse 17 says, Jesus is our merciful and faithful high priest. And as the high priest, Jesus alone would once and for all turn aside God's wrath and take away God's wrath by atoning for our sins. This is the first mention of Jesus as priest, and we are going to dive deep into this idea in a few chapters, for a few chapters. But for now, let's summarize the author's argument. He says, how can anyone follow angels when the Son of God has come. Are you worshiping angels? Do you have them in your house, and are you having them as an idol, or do you see Jesus? Because we see Jesus. We see Jesus restore our relationship to God, and we see Jesus release the burden of guilt and shame, and we see Jesus reveal strength and wisdom for life's journey. So here's what I pray you believe. Jesus came as our atoning sacrifice and secured our salvation. Jesus came as our atoning sacrifice and secured our salvation. Will you please? Jesus, you alone are the one who came to do this mighty work, only through you walking through this life as our perfect and sinless sacrifice were you able to hang on the cross and bear the full weight of all of our sins, all of the sins that we've committed in the past, the sins that we're doing right now, the sins that we will do forever until you bring us home. We thank you for these truths that the Hebrews author chose to record to help us understand how extremely valuable you are, that nothing compares to you, that we treasure you more than anything else as our great Redeemer, the Son of God, our great High Priest, the one we put our faith in. Your name, precious Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you.